surpasses all understanding, an assurance of his loving presence during this time, with heartfelt prayers and sympathy from the Luckett, Holloway, Hudson family. We have one additional. Just to remind you, you're not alone, that thoughts are with you, memories surround you, and friends all around you from the Armstead family. Thank you.
Family, I'm truly gonna give my sincere condolences to you during this difficult time. And at this time, I'm going to read the obituary of Brenda L. Madison. Brenda Lucille Madison was born May the 29th, 1957, in Moline, Illinois, the daughter of John and Dolores Madison. She worked for the University of Phoenix, and I could vouch for that. We sent off many of emails. Chatting while we were working, and she enjoyed sewing. Brenda is survived by two beautiful daughters, Kamisha and husband Johnny Lee of Glendale, Arizona, and Delia Dee Dee Madison of Carrollton, Texas. Nine grandchildren. That's a legacy, right? That's a legacy. Nine grandchildren and seven great-grandchildren. Wow, what a legacy. And siblings, Tony, wife Regina, Bruce of Durant, Iowa, and Terry Cooper of Rock Island. She was preceded in death by her parents and a brother, John Madison. Family, this is the obituary of our dear, loved mother, grandmother, friend, colleague, Brenda L. Madison. Thank you.
Okay, I'm here to read the memories, but first I want to provide my memory. I met Brenda in the 90s. I can't remember exactly when she moved here, but I was too working for University of Phoenix. Most of us have. I did my 20. And Dee Dee, Kamisha, and Charles, all of us are kind of from the Midwest. And she was talking to me about her mom was coming, and she wanted a job. Well, a lot of people had helped me get on board, so I was pretty close to the vice president of at that particular time. And I talked to her about Brenda. And she goes, okay, well, if it's coming from your church family, I'll go ahead and hire her. So Brenda and I were not too far away from each other. We'd see each other, sometimes carpool, but always the emails, the jokes, the laughter. It was just hilarious with Brenda never had a dull moment that I can remember. And then to come find out, me being from the Midwest, from Omaha, Rock Island and Des Moines, Iowa, is not too far away. I have a lot of family there. And then to find out that she even knows my family. So, of course, the family with us and all of the Madisons and the Wells, we were already established. And it was just a wonderful time spending with Brenda. Tell you, she was a funny lady. She really was, and don't cross her because she knew how to put you right in your spot. Yes, with a smile on her face. Praise God. Okay, one of the memories came from Deb McNeil. Okay, thank you. I really loved your mom. We had so many memories together that I'll never forget since the fifth grade. Harmony Hall dances at Central Junior High. She always had my back. That's what kind of friend she was. We went through a lot together. She always spoke her mind, yes, and that's what made her a fighter. She was a strong and caring woman. And from Cal Walraven, I'm so sad to hear this. Brenda was one of my favorite people who I worked with at UOP. She kept me humble and always made me laugh. Some of the best memories there are with her. My condolences to you and your family. She was a special one, and she will be missed. From Gwen Melvin, so sorry for your loss. She was one of my favorite people. Thoughts and prayers with you and family. God bless. Then we have some more memories from John P. You'll always be in my heart. The everything else, there's nothing but love. And then Mama B, thank you for your laugh, your smile, and sharing your family with us. You will be missed. From Lashana Taylor. There will always be a place at my table for you. God bless. Sandra Williams. And then we have to Kamisha and Didi, from sharing loss of my own mother over 20 years, I feel your pain. I promise to keep the prayers coming, and if you ever just need to talk, don't hesitate to call me. I am here for you. Cheryl, better known as Mima. Then we have, love you, Granny, so much. Always have and always will. Something I didn't get to tell you, but you'll always know. Mackie. And the last one from Tamika. It's so fitting that it's a rainy day. I remember your mom hated driving in the rain so much that she called off every time, exactly, every time it rained. So living in Phoenix was a perfect cause. It hardly rains here. Now, every time it rains, I smile in remembrance of her talking crazy when it rained. These are the memories of wonderful Brenda Madison. Truly, truly, she was a gift to all of us, and she will be missed. God bless you, family.
Our scripture reading comes from the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 and onwards. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left unto the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will ever be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Amen.
Family, I know that this is tough, but do know that your family is here to support you. And I'm going to try to get through this song. I hear that one of Brenda's favorite songs was Alabaster Box, so I'll be singing that song. But I will say this, the one thing that I am so grateful for from Brenda is my two sisters. Our family has a lot of twists and turns. But, man, these two ladies have been such a blessing to my life. And so I can't, that had to come from someone beautiful, to give me something so beautiful. So I'm so grateful for that.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whispering, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, till at last she knelt before his feet. Though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard, as she poured her love for the Master from her box of alabaster. I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. Can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sins that had me bound. And I spent my days pouring my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonders of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so much. I come to pour my praise on Him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair.
Like Tanika said, don't try to figure this family out. Just go with the flow. Am I right? Just go with the flow. Because I knew Brenda at a young age, Dee Dee asked me to say some things. I wanted to jot them down because I wanted to make sure that I got everything. I met Brenda when I was 15 and she was 13. She was a quiet kind of person and usually did not say much. She was what you would call an introvert. Very nice, tended to stop and think before she spoke. She enjoyed hanging around just a small group of friends. I never saw her with a lot of people. She loved to, well, we all came from the ghetto, okay? We was in the hood. All right, I'm just going to tell you, that's how it is. And either you laughed with each other or you laughed at each other. Isn't that right? That's what you do. Kamisha, your mannerisms are close to your mom. I know you don't want to hear that, but it is, they are. And Brenda and I, when we were teenagers, we were in a relationship in high school, and which resulted in the birth of Kamisha. 2 years after that, Dee Dee came along. At the age of 26, I gave my life to Christ. And anytime I ran into my old friends, I would tell them the change that I made because they knew I was out in the clubs and I was doing all these drugs and stuff. But then when they saw me, I was cleaned up. But when I ran into Brenda, she wasn't like other people. We were friends all through until she passed. We were friends. She was never like, well, I don't want to talk to you because you got Christ now. She never was like that. She never kicked me to the curb and You know, you lose a lot of your friends when you come to Christ. Your friends in the streets, that is. But she was never like that. Most people tend to avoid you and stay away. She continued to be the same person I had met 11 years prior. She didn't like to talk, at least to me, okay? I did a lot of talking. But she did ask questions, and she did listen. And when she came out here, she actually did give her life to the Lord. I do want to stop and say this. Brenda had two amazing daughters who are loving, caring, responsible, thoughtful. I mean, I looked all these words up because I had to say it. They're both strong, kind-hearted, smart. And if y'all disagree, you just say. I'm hearing you say yes. They were courageous. They were optimistic. They're wise. They're fearless, empathetic, and mature. And they are loved by family and friends. Okay, so now we're going to fast forward to Arizona. Brenda moved out here. And yes, she did work at UOP. We all worked at UOP. We all worked at UOP. Cheryl and I, we would go, and I know that when she lived up here on Thomas, we would go and visit her there. We'd always try to keep the conversation positive and, you know, encourage her. In February of this year, last month, I traveled back to Illinois because I had helped some family members with some issues. And Dee Dee had informed me. We had kept an eye because we had known that she was kind of digressing. And Dee Dee told me that she was getting sick. She was going down here. One Sabbath, Kay and I, my older sister, we went to see Brenda. And you know how it is. We went back to the hood again. We talked about all the stuff we used to do and crazy stuff. And you know, my sister Kate, she's a clown anyway, so she always has to bring up things. But then two Saturdays later, some of you guys, I went back to see her, and I was by myself. And Brenda and I, we talked about how we met. We talked about crazy things that happened back in the day. And then I shared some Bible studies, the Bible verses with her about God's love for us. And I followed up with a song. I'm just going to give you a little piece of it. It said, talk about a child that do love Jesus. Here is one. Talk about a child that's been converted. Yea, is one. Yea, is one. I sang that song to her, and her next door neighbor, who was sitting in the bed next, she turned off her radio. She wanted to hear it too. And at the close of the song, I prayed for Brenda, and I ask God to forgive her, forgive me of our sins, and that she would ask God into her life again. When I started to pray, Brenda grabbed my hand really tightly, and we prayed. And I saw that peace come over her face. Because you know how it is, y'all, when you get up in age, you start thinking about a lot of stuff you've done in your life. And you wonder, if I could change it, can I change it? Okay, if I could just go back and change it. But you can't. And so the next thing you ask for is God to forgive you for all those things you did. And we all come from screwed up lives, haven't we? So when I left, I said to her on the way out, I whispered and I said, listen, I will see you in heaven. Praise God.
Amen. So at this time, we're going to have reflections. And we're going to ask that you not go over 2 minutes. So I'm going to be watching. But if you could just come up to the front right behind LaWanda Roberson to start your reflections. And I just want to say one other thing about Brenda. We would go to lunch because at the time our location of UOP was at College in Curry, and we would sometimes go to lunch, and we would go to this one thrift shop as well, and we just had a good time. One day she goes, "You're gonna get me fired. You're not gonna get fired because you're a boss, but you're gonna get me fired, girl. We've been gone 2 hours." She says, "I'm not going to lunch with you no more." So the next day we went just to McDonald's. I'm telling you, you know, where I'm hearing that she was quiet. Brenda was so funny. I don't understand where that part came from, but that's okay. Every gathering that we had at the family's house, she was hilarious. But I can tell you one thing, Dee Dee and Kamisha and Johnny, both Johnny, and Damien, she loved you guys a lot. She would talk about you guys. All of her grandchildren, she would talk about. We would talk about our kids and just everything. She was so loving. So I know that you're hurting right now, but you hurt knowing that she loved you guys a lot. And she only wished the best for each and every one of you. So take comfort in that. Take comfort in that. So we'll begin now.
Also worked at UOP. But before that, they had Take Your Children to Work Day. And I wasn't able to go with my mom. And grandma was like, "Come with me." And I had some of the funnest times with her because she would teach me how to type. Little did I know I'd be working there typing. So she trained me a little. Me and my cousins used to always go to her house to swim. When we were younger, our parents would drop us off. And for a while, I'd be like, "Why do I have to come over here? She has these cats." And I'm allergic to cats. And mom would be like, "Take this Benadryl." "You're still going." But we loved every minute of it. We would always go. She had these DVDs, bootleg DVDs. And she was like, "Pick your movie out. I have the snacks." She taught me how to sew because she loved clothes. She was always so fashionable. And she would take something and change it completely. And you'd just be like, "Oh, wow." But I just want her to know that I love her. And she will never be forgotten. And I learned so much from her. Thank you.
Is there anyone else? If you can, you could just come around and say your words. Again, I want to get condolences to the family. Dee Dee, Kamisha, Johnny, Damien. The other Johnny's not here. The grandchildren,
great-grands, Brenda did love her family. She loved you guys dearly. As Charles said it perfectly, no one's perfect. And we have no judgment. All we have is love, right? And so through it all in all, these tears is because you love your mom and your grandma, right? So Brenda left that legacy behind to love one another. Don't be judging each other. Just love one another because all of us have our time. And we want to make sure our calling in this election is sure. Brenda made sure hers was sure. Brenda got baptized. And I love what Charles said, that he prayed with her at the hospital bed and she squeezed his hand. She heard the prayers of her friend. So let's pray for one another. God is not at a distance. He's right here. Don't forget who he is. And let's not wait until we get in trouble before we allow him in our hearts. Just like Brenda loved her family unconditionally, you guys, allow God in your heart so you can love each other unconditionally. Don't hate on each other. Love on each other. So Brenda and I, Brenda worked, all of us worked at UOP, but Brenda used to text, I mean, not text, but email me, because she worked at a different department. We had incoming mail, right? And she worked at university service, and we were operations. And she was like, what's all this work? All these faxes coming through here. And I'm like, I know, girls, call job security. I said, let the faxes come. And so sometimes her job could be a headache, right? And she'll send me an email. They're giving me a headache. I say, okay, let's just pray about it, right? And so we had this back and forth when I was filling up my head. I was like, okay, I'm over this. I'll send her an email. She'll send something back quirky or funny. I'll laugh about it. But that was the good thing with us all working at UOP. We could come together, not just church. We were a family at church and at work. We took over UOP. And people were like, you're from Beacon Light Church too? We all was from Beacon Light Church. And I think Charles got us all hired. It started from Charles. But I just want to say, family, Brenda was loved. I don't know her as a mother. I don't know her as a grandmother. But I do know her as a friend. And she will be missed. And she is loved. So again, love one another as your grandmother have loved you. Amen.
Hello. Name's Trey. I also worked at University of Phoenix. I got my 4-year gold star. I don't know what I was going to say when I got up here, but Koya was right about the DVDs, the bootleg. Living with Grandma was great because I got to learn a lot about her, learn about how she loved, learn that she loved plastic bowls, and I didn't like that with my milk. So when I had cereal, it was warm, man. I'm like, why are we always eating all these plastic, these paper plates you got to throw away? I'm like, but then now in my house, I do the same thing. I'm like, I'm not doing dishes. I'm just not going to do it. And I'm like, oh, okay, I get it. But I also got to watch Titanic for the first time, and I realized they had 2 cassettes. And I was like, Grandma, why are we watching this long movie? She's like, you got to get the other tape. I'm like, the other tape? Why is there 2? But she made the best carrot cake I ever had. I don't know how she did it, because she had the box, but then you ate it. I'm like, that didn't come from the box, though. They didn't have those little almonds in there. I'm like, how'd you put that in there? Where'd you get that from? But like everyone else, I loved her a lot. We shared the same birthday. Yeah. I don't know what I was going to say. So that's, again, we all love her. I a lot of times try to make her upset just to see how mad she would get and go off. I don't know if I was the only one that did that, but I definitely did that for fun. It became a household thing. I almost didn't know anybody else, but we loved it, and we love her, so yeah.
my Aunt Brenda, man, she didn't know. I never told her. Never told anybody. But aside from my sisters and brother-in-law, after I moved out here and I was, you know, in Phoenix for a while, my aunt was my comfort zone. I would go over there on Friday nights, and me and her would just sit back and talk like Madisons do. You know, we talk crazy to each other, laugh, but, you know, this was, you know, my mom's sister. I was, you know, her closest nephew besides my little brother. And we had a really good, me and Mom Brenda had a really good relationship. We really did. She knew I would do, my whole family knows I do things that make no sense half the time, but, and I did what my nephew did, and, you know, went over there one night, and I did what I knew would get her heated, and she got heated, and, but the thing is, we had such a solid relationship before then. We went months without talking. She wouldn't talk to me. But without any conversation later, without any apology, it rolled over like it never happened. And we went back to how it's always been. One of the last times that I seen her, and we talked for a few minutes, me and my wife went over to Dee Dee's house that she had before she moved to Texas, and I had my Jeep, and I said, I'm gonna get her. So I pulled up in the driveway real quick, and she was sitting outside, and the garage was open, and she hopped up. She said, hey, Damien. I said, Brenda, I said, I need to hide my Jeep. And I, you know, I asked a friend. And seeing me the way I was, she was wavering. Is this the new in rehab, Damien? Or is this my old nephew that, you know? She wasn't sure, and she looked at me. She said, Damien, what'd you do? And I started cracking up, nothing, Aunt Brenda, nothing. I was messing with you. She looked at me. But we had a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun. My memories go all the way back to when I was a kid. Her, my birthdays, every year for my birthday, she'd make me a barbecue rib dinner. So all the way from then till now, I got a few aunts, but she was the only one I had a real relationship, and I always loved her to death. And just like everyone else, we're all human, but deep down, Mom Brenda was a really good person.
I said I wasn't going to talk, but I'm going to try to tell this story. It's a funny story, so. When we want to cheer my mom up, or we want to just, I just got to tell you. So my husband here, y'all know Johnny, and it's him. So in North Carolina, my mom lived with us a lot throughout our marriage. We've been married, it'll be 33 years. I think my mom lived with us most of the time, it feels like. So anyway, North Carolina times, Trey was little. I think we may have had Jaleesa at the time. And we went fishing. We went fishing with some church friends, and then we brought the fish home. My mom doesn't really care for fish. She don't like to eat fish. She doesn't want to touch fish. I don't know. We were about to clean the fish, and my mom came in. I think she was smoking. She came in from outside, and as I believe this is my story, as she was walking in from the stairs, my husband decided to chase my mom with the fish. So she tried to backpedal down the steps. I don't know. She fell at that time, but she was running and saying, Johnny, no. But he decided to chase her with the fish. And so I think recently when we went to go see her, I don't know, did you threaten her with the fish again? And even though she was in the wheelchair, you threatened her with the fish. So she loved her some Henry. I know he's going to miss her dearly because she really loved Henry. And when she got mad, she called him Henry. And when she would call him Johnny, then I think he knew she was mad at him. So that's the story I just wanted to tell you. I'm just snitching on him. All right, that's it. So we all loved her, so.
Hello, everybody. Maggie. Everybody know me, I guess. I don't know. Memories from my grandma. Since I left, every time I came back, she's always wants to go to IHOP. IHOP was her favorite breakfast. Even if it was lunchtime, still, it was the move. You know, everybody know me. I'm lovey-dovey touchy. I like to touch everybody. So I started a thing just to touch grandma's skin. She didn't like it. She didn't like it at all. I just like, you know, she had rolls right here and mess with it. Rolls everywhere. I used to touch it. And it was just something I did, you know. Just show her love, though. Just show her, grandma, I love you. And just, this is something I remember. I always did. I don't know why, but yeah.
I'm not a public speaker. I don't even hold microphones like that. But Savon, my grandchild, I don't even know what to say, but I'm going to regret not coming up here if I don't say something. But everybody's hitting it straight on the head. Like, my grandma she shows love different, that's for sure. You got to kind of push it out of her, so everybody done develop the mess with her type, you know. You don't mess with her, get a reaction, but like, because she has so much character, you know what I mean? You never know what reaction to get at her. And, you know, it's just another way of just bonding, just how I mess with, you know, my siblings and whatnot. But it's just one way I mess with her all the time. I can't even explain to you how I did, but yeah. But man, I remember the Ninja Turtles. I remember the bootleg movies, too. I remember that bootleg movie too. I remember going with John Tell. We were watching Ninja Turtles. I mean, like, not the cartoon one, the one when they're real people in a suit. And it looked creepy. Yeah, all the way back. Yeah, but Psycho, Chaos, those were the cats, white and black. I remember it all. I think my grandma Brenda, that's the first time I ate two old school Whoppers, the big Jones, yeah. So I was like, and they're like, I don't even remember, like $1.50. They're probably even less then. So I mean, I was 10. But yeah, you definitely wanted to come up here and say something because, like, I don't go to funerals a lot, and this is definitely really special because my grandma is definitely like a best friend. I'm not gonna lie, like a best friend. Like. She's the type to be like, you'll come to her with a problem, or you'll come to her trying to fix a problem that she has. you end up leaving, fixing your own problem. it's just crazy. You never know what you're gonna get with talking to her, and I'm just mad that she's gone. I'm mad. I'm not even sad. I'm mad because I'm starting chapters of my life. She's not gonna be here. I got twins coming on the way in August. And when I told her, it's not the reaction that I wanted, you know? Because I knew she had something else to say. But she couldn't say it. So it's just so much. I wasn't ready. That's all. I wasn't ready. So like everyone's saying, you know, live in the moment. Tell everybody you love them now because we're not going to have, we can't control everything, you know?
Yeah. I'm gonna be real quick, because I don't like talking in front of people, but she was just my Norma, is what I called her. She called me anime, because we crazy, and we talk crazy to each other. But one thing I didn't get to tell her, which I'm pregnant, and I wanted to tell her, but it was too late, because I wanted to wait for a certain time after my first trimester, but didn't get to tell her. So that's all I wanted to say.
Little Norma?
Yes, my name is Little Norma. No.
I'm Azaria. I remember, like Koya said, University of Phoenix. I remember definitely Aunt Myla. I remember seeing the freeway every time getting dropped off. Didn't know where I was going a lot. Everybody knows I was always with my grandmothers. My grandmother Lockett, my grandma Brenda, they taught me everything. I discovered pudding cups through my grandma, my grandma Brenda for sure. I feel like we were roommates a lot of times. Neighbors. When we were neighbors, that was amazing. She would just always be so welcoming, even though we knew she didn't want to really be around us. She would still welcome us in and, I mean, get us settled, get us a snack, and make sure that we were ready to end the day with her. Normally, we did end our Saturdays and Sundays with her. Yeah, the cereal thing.
We had our own cereal.
We had our own cereal. Oh, wow. She discovered it. I think it was at the dollar store. Yeah. It was her favorite cereal to feed us, even though we didn't like it. But my last words with my grandmother were short. A lot of things I wish I could have told her. A lot of times I wish I could have been there for her when I know she needed us the most and we weren't there. When did we go see her? When was the last time I seen her? I just know we were taking her to her tigers that she wanted. Yeah. And then when they got there, she didn't want them. So it was really just a good trip to see her smile. I wish I could see that smile every day. But most of all, I know she loved all of us, and she's looking over all of us. She's here with us. And I'm going to wear her on my neck every day until it's my turn, you know? But we will see each other soon, and it will be a time that we will all remember, just like the memories we have with her now.
Just like my mom, I wasn't going to get up here and say anything. But a little bit after I had my son, I talked to Grandma. I called her. And she just kind of said a few things to me regarding being a mother. She told me to continue to stay strong and that I was a really good mom. And I just told her, like, I miss her, and I wish she was here to meet my son. Cause she spent all of Jordan's life with her, so it just was a really bittersweet feeling. But I definitely will never forget the conversation I had with her. Kind of being young and coming into this family, it definitely was different, but and the love was very different, but it was real, it was genuine, and I appreciated Grandma for always being there for me when I really didn't have a lot of people to talk to, or a lot of people didn't understand me. So I'm definitely gonna miss her, and I just really wish she would have met my son. So. For a little bit, but.
We all work there. Okay. Well, we just want to continue to remember the wonderful memories that we had with Brenda. And one thing that I did want to say, but I forgot, is, you know what? Tamika mentioned that there's a lot of twists and turns. That's in everybody's family. We all have different fabrics of life running through us. But Tamika, I want you to know, I watched her, and she loved you.
Oh, yeah.
She loved her, Miss Tamika, and treated her just like she was hers. So Brenda had a heart of gold, and Damien, I want to hear what she actually told you. I can only imagine. Okay. Right. At this time, we will have a reading poem from her daughter, Dee Dee.
So, yes, I too worked at UOP. I think we should start a support group for all of those that worked at UOP. Tamika was mom's sweet child. That's what she would say. She's the sweet child. Kamisha and I were not. And I don't know why she thought that. But a friend of mine says, Tamika gives you that elegant shade. Is that it? You don't realize she's doing it. You'd be like, did she just? Okay, as everybody said, my mother was unique. That's the best word to describe mom. Yeah. She was unique. And I wrote this. I had a hard time with it, but I did my best. Mommy, the road wasn't easy throughout your life. The ups, the downs, the challenges, the strife. You fought as a child from the early start. You fought to find the love buried deep down in your heart. You fought for your place in this world, for your independence, and for your child. You fought all the hate and accusations sent your way based on what you did. You fought your addiction day in and day out. You fought disease bout after bout. You fought when the doctors told us to come that your time was running out. You fought like a soldier for several decades without a doubt. You fought and you fought. No matter what come, you fought and you fought until finally you were done. You fought to the day your mind had succumbed to your weary body and heart that had grown numb, numb to this world, numb to the pain, numb to the need to live it this way. You decided to stop and fight no more. You decided on your terms to leave this world. So today we gather in honor of you. We love you. We remember the fight and the spirit that has now withdrew.
That was beautiful. My name is Tamika Winston, and I worked for University of Phoenix. So, almost sounds like a sentence, a prison term. So, the next song that I'm going to sing is Take Me to the King. And I feel like it's so fitting because life is hard. Life is hard, and we really can't we can't keep that weight on our shoulders, because not only will it make us crazy, but we can't handle that. Only God can handle it. And so I hope that this blesses the family, and just know that you can take whatever you need to take to the King. Trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't fake what's left to do. Truth is, I'm weak. No strength to fight, no tears to cry, even if I try. But still my soul refuses to die. Mm-hmm. One touch will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory. Sing to you this song. Please take me to the King. Truth is, it's time to stop playing these games. 'Cause we need a word for the people's pain. So Lord, speak right now. Let we're desperate, we're chasing after you, you. Oh, no rules, no religion. I've made my decision to run to you, the healer that I need. Take me to the King. Don't have much to pray, and my heart's torn to pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at your throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory and to sing to you. To bring, and my heart's torn to pieces. It's my offering. Leave me there. I want to gaze upon your glory. Yeah.
You all made me feel left out because I never worked at UOP. I didn't know Brenda, but I feel like I knew her because I knew those who belonged to her. There's one thing about the family. There are very few places I go and families that I go to and always feel short. When I come among even the females in the family after. That's a strange experience for me. But in thinking of you and thinking of your dear mother, I jotted some things here that I would share with you. Have you heard of the term natural death? Like someone has died a natural death? There is nothing like a natural death. Death is unnatural. That's why we can never become accustomed to it. We were made to live, not to die. Death is an interloper, an intruder, an invader. He rears his ugly head where he is not wanted and where he is not invited. And life would be unbearable. The loss of a loved one would have been unsustainable were it not for the hope beyond the grave. And maybe hope is not the right word, at least the way we understand hope, or the way we use the word hope today. Hope in human everyday usage has a measure of uncertainty. If someone says to you, "I hope to be there tomorrow," there is no certainty in that statement. It means I want to be there. I'm planning to be there, but I can't be absolutely certain. If I were certain, I would say, "I will be there." The dictionary says hope means a feeling of expectation and desire for a certain thing to happen. A feeling of expectation or a desire on my part for the thing to happen doesn't mean it will happen. Then another definition says to look forward with desire. That part is good, to look forward with desire. But then it says, unreasonable confidence. Reasonable confidence? Would you stake your life on reasonable confidence? Absolutely not. So what is this biblical hope we talk about when we bid goodbye to a loved one? What is it that causes us not to abandon ourselves to grief? What is it that bids us? What is it that holds us when our hearts are wrung with sadness and the loss of someone who cannot be replaced? What is this biblical hope that enables us to grieve but not to be consumed by grief? As I checked into it, the original language of the New Testament is Greek, so the word that is translated hope for us in English is a Greek word called elpida. And when I checked the meaning of elpida, it says profound certainty. That's what the original language means when we use the English word hope. Profound certainty, powerful assurance, expectation of what is certain. So there is a little problem when we use English and read some English words into Bible text, because the word that means total assurance in Greek means not so sure in English. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13, St. Paul says to us, to you this afternoon, you don't need to sorrow as those who have no hope, because you do have hope, understanding that this hope that St. Paul is talking about is profound certainty, powerful assurance, an expectation of something that is certain. And wow, it's Easter Sunday. The day that word spread like wildfire way back then, he is risen. That word spread like wildfire, he is risen, after hope was dashed, after they were mocked and laughed at, after they had gone home dejected, discouraged, disheartened, and disillusioned. They had gone home without hope. This Jesus, they had invested so much in him. They had seen him walk on water. He stilled a killer storm by speaking to it. They had seen him raise the dead. And so they were confused when he allowed them to arrest him. The disciples were like, why is he permitting them to arrest him, to take him? And that is part of why they ran. They ran because in their heads he was refusing to use his power, the power that they knew he had, to free himself and to handle the stuff. And it confused them, so they ran. And many times as human beings, we too are tempted to run away from God because he doesn't use his power in the way we think he should. Could I say that again? We sometimes run away from God because he doesn't use his power in the way we think he should. Obviously, there are stuff we don't understand. Number one, he never promised that our hearts won't be wrung with anguish. You read the Bible. He never promised that. Number two, he never promised that we would understand all of his actions or non-action. We always want to understand what God is doing, but he is God. How could we understand him? So let me put you on the spot because you're in front. Who is this lady with you here? It's your wife. How long are you married? Almost 4 years. Let me go to somebody who has a little more experience than you. 3.5 years is good, but he's the guy next to you. You. Okay. Johnny, how long are you married? How many? 33 years. You're an experienced man in this thing. You are with this lady 33 years, right? So I'm going to ask you something in front of everybody. You ready? No, don't look at them. Don't let them prompt you. Right? Hey. You have been married for 33 years. You're in church. You need to answer truthfully. You have been married to Kamisha for 33 years. Do you understand always everything? You hear the answer? The man has been married for 33 years to the same woman, and he could say before I finish the question, I don't understand everything about her. But we want to understand God. Got it? You can't even understand completely somebody who you live with for 33 years, but we expect to understand God? Obviously we can't. Our minds can't take him in. So he's going to do stuff or not do stuff that will puzzle us. He never promised unbroken happiness or unalloyed peace. He never promised that we would understand all his actions or his non-actions, because sometimes we want him to act a certain way. Sometimes we wonder why he's seemed to be doing nothing. But he always has a plan with our best interests in mind. We just don't understand. You ask a little baby, a child, to understand all that the parents are doing. Explain to a little child why the loving mother would take the little child, take it to a strange office, hand the child over to a stranger, and stand there while the stranger takes a sharp needle and pokes the child in his hand. You explain that to that little child. Could never understand. But you do it out of love. So sometimes we are hurt and we wonder why God doesn't step in, why he doesn't prevent the hurt. But God loves us more than any human parent or anybody could love us. And he always has a plan for us. Sometimes he doesn't give us all that we need because he wants to remind us that this is not home. Why doesn't God do this? Why doesn't God do that? Why doesn't God? This is not home. But we want to feel like if it's home. We want to live like if it's home. We want all the comforts of home. But he says it's not going to happen here. My child, I love you. And there's stuff you won't understand now, but one day you would. But I have a plan to end all this thing that is called pain and sorrow and death. I have a plan, and it's coming. We just need to trust him. We just need to have faith and confidence in him. And when we are hurting, he doesn't turn his back. He holds us in his arms. And he rocks us in his arms until our spirits are quieted and we receive strength to go on. So yes, this parting is sorrowful. It will hurt. You will experience pain. But one thing God has always promised. He said, no matter what you go through, I will always be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. No matter how alone you feel sometimes, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So he's going to keep you He's going to hold you. He's going to continue loving you. And I pray that you just don't pull your hands away from him, because one day it will be explained and you would say, God, Father, thank you for not giving in to my tantrums when I didn't understand, because you are the all-wise God. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your promise that you will be with us. Because if you are with us, really we don't have anything to fear. There are many times we do not understand what you are doing or what you are not doing. But we have enough sense and enough experience. You have showed us enough to know that you are the all-wise God. And we are just human. We wouldn't always understand. But you have given us enough to trust you. And because it's Easter Sunday, we remember when the disciples were flustered. They were confused. They were scared out of their wits. They thought for a few hours that they had made the mistake of their lives when they had given up all to follow Jesus, thinking he was the Savior of the world. And then they saw him strung up upon a cross, bleeding and dying like any other human being. And they thought, they said, we thought he was the one. But you did come through. On Sunday morning, they saw beyond the shadow of a doubt that indeed he was the one. Be God to this family. Hold them. Wrap them in your arms. Help them to remember the good times when the enemy would come and try to push that weight of sadness on them. Help them to look up and thank you for the good times they have shared with Brenda. And oh God, help us to so live that when that day comes, when you make up your number from above, that each one of the children and relatives and friends, yea, all of us, would be there in that great reunion, never more to part. We give you thanks and praise for your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
The family wants to thank everyone for coming out and supporting them during this difficult time. This concludes the service for Brenda, Madison. The family will greet you, or they could sit here on the main seat. If you want to come up at this time and greet the family, you can do that. We can start around the back and come around and make your way to the front. Just to give your love, show your love and condolences to the family. Thank you.